Now that we understand the distributed object model of Java and how to build services using the distributed Java object model and publish it and make it accessible to the clients, let's look at how the RMI is actually implemented. At the core of the RMI implementation is this layer called Remote Reference Layer, RRL, and that's the place where a lot of magic happens. The client-side stub is going to initiate a remote method invocation call using this remote reference layer. And all of the magic with respect to marshaling the arguments in order to send it over the network and so on is handled entirely by this remote reference layer. And similarly, when the result comes back, unmarshaling the results into the data structures that the client understands is once again accomplished using this RRL layer. On the server side, the skeleton that exists is there for unmarshaling the arguments that comes from the client. And in order to unmarshal the arguments, the skeleton uses the remote reference layer because the remote reference layer knows how to unmarshal the arguments that are coming in. And the skeleton then makes the call up to the server that is implementing the remote object. Once the server is done with the service, the skeleton marshals the result and once again goes through the remote reference layer to send it over to the client. And when it comes back, the remote reference layer and the stub work together to deliver the results in a digestible format to the client. So marshaling and unmarshaling, they're also called serializing and deserialization in the Java world. Marshaling and unmarshaling are also called serializing and deserializing Java objects, and all of that is being done by the RRL layer. So basically, the objects that are being passed as arguments, they are serialized by the RRL and deserialized on the server end and given to the server. And similarly, the result, which is also an object, is serialized using the remote reference layer. And when it arrives on the client side, it is deserialized and delivered as a result object back up to the client. Now, where are the clients and the servers? Are they on the same machine or a different machine? Of course, we are talking about networked services, and so the server is going to be remote. But the server could have several instances. There could be a single instance of a server, or there could be multiple instances of the server, and the server may have ability for doing persistence and so on. Where is all that magic happening? Well, similar to the subcontract layer that we discussed in the Spring system, the remote reference layer is doing all the magic with respect to where the server is, how the server is handling requests, is it replicated, is it a singleton server? All of these things are being handled through the remote reference layer. So what that means is, it allows for various invocation protocols between the client and the servers. And all of those things are buried in the remote reference layer, and the actual clients and the servers can be impervious to those details. So in the Java runtime stack, the RRL layer is a very crucial layer, and it has functionalities very similar to the subcontract mechanism in the Spring system. And as I mentioned earlier, the Java RMI derives a lot from the subcontract mechanism, and so there is not much surprise that there are similarities between the RRL layer and the subcontract mechanism. Having discussed RRL, let's go and talk about the transport layer.